Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, we're talking about agriculture and the growing demand for food on this planet. Ted Bilyea is the Chief Strategy Officer for the Canadian Agri-Food Policy Institute. And before that, he was the Executive VP of Maple Leaf Foods. He knows what he's talking about. Very happy to have you here, Ted. Let's just dive right in. What are our current challenges when it comes to, you know, our food chain and food value?
I guess one of the most difficult issues for many people to understand is that when we're talking about the general concept of food security, for example, and many people are coming out of the COVID struggles that we've had, it means different things to different people in different countries. In the Canadian situation, for example, food security is largely an income security issue. It can be also a distribution problem for our northern communities, for example. That's distribution is a reality, but fundamentally, food insecurity in Canada is more about income. It's not about the lack of food per se. One of the most interesting things is that the COVID situation really highlighted the connection between income and food security, in the sense that we went from, according to Stats Canada, we went from about 1 in 10 people that were food insecure in Canada to about 1 in 8. But that, again, is something that can be handled, because we are sitting with one of the largest surpluses of food in the world and for our population. If you look at the global food insecurity, you get a completely different picture. So you have, if you think about it, about 93% of the growth in the world, both population income, is going to come from essentially Africa and Asia, and the together, and the vast majority of that from Africa. And that is an area which is basically food insecure at the moment. It's one that we're going to have to think about deeply. So the OECD has kind of projected that several of these countries are going to become even more insecure.
I mean, there's Canada, and then there's our global community.
That's right.
And we're all connected. So you're saying that, like, could we as Canadians, could we feed ourselves if we had to, like, as a country? Like, do we produce enough here to feed all Canadians?
That is a trickier question than it appears. The answer is obviously we can, because we are massively food surplus. We have very, very small population for the amount of arable land that we have and the amount of food we produce. But there's a nuance to that question, and that's one that we need to think about. And that is that if I handed you a bushel of wheat and said, here, you have here's two or three bushels of wheat, you know, and here's a bushel of canola, and I know you don't want to eat meat, but here's a cow. Now you're food secure. And that describes Canada a little bit too well in some respects, because we do have a food processing industry, but we are a little less productive than we should be in processing our own food. And most people require some kind of, you know, you're probably more likely to want to buy bread or at least flour rather than that bushel of wheat. And you probably don't know what to do with a bushel of canola. I couldn't make canola oil from it at home, but it would be very difficult. So that's essentially a different issue, one we need to work on increasing our ability to add value to our commodities in Canada. But from the rest of the world's point of view, they're very happy that we have these commodities that we can share. It is important to understand that the world is not the same. There are countries that have, you know, surplus food, but don't have the income to buy their own food. That's becoming an issue in South America as their exports are beginning to drive up their food prices. It's a big problem there. And there's other countries that have neither the food nor the income So there's some countries have the don't have enough food, but they've got plenty of income, such as China. So they can buy massive quantities of food from anywhere they want. So it's a complex. The world is totally connected in the food industry. Huh? It's local food is interesting, and we do see a lot of it, particularly in the summertime. But that's the fringe. It's the global food industry that keeps millions of people fed is one where most of it starts locally. But the key is the margin that allows people to survive, that trades internationally. And it goes where the money is.
Right. So what concerns you when it comes to food security? And there we have billions of people on this planet, and are we sustainable? Are farmers we hear about farmers when countries aren't getting along, and there's going to be tariffs on this and tariffs on that, and then everybody gets upset or something, there's some sort of disease that goes through, a food industry of some sort. Mm-hmm. That's when we hear about farmers and we hear about, the struggles. What are your concerns when it comes to sustainability?
Let's parse that a little bit,
Okay.
You just unloaded the huge...
I'm sorry.
The question that keeps us all awake all the time. Let's start out by looking at talk a little bit about our bio capacity in Canada. So if you reach right back into it, you ask the fundamental question is bio capacity. Sometimes people call it natural capital. What is that like in Canada versus other places in the world? And you begin to we can build from there a bit. But if you think of Canada. We have about an 1.2 hectares of arable land per person. There's only three countries in the world that have more than 1 hectare of arable land per person. So, and Canada's one of those. It's a big drop, to the rest of the countries. And the reason again is because we have such a small population. We really can't understand ourselves because we're a very low populated country. It's not that we have massive amounts of arable land in total land. Canada is such a big place, that only about 7% of our land is actually arable. But having said that, we still have an abundance of it for population base. So that's like between 13 and 14 times what the average person in China has for arable land.
Right. So and when you say arable land, what do you mean by that?
These are land you can essentially grow crops on, and you could do it by agricultural land, and it works out about the same as well. But that's essentially what we're talking about. And so we are losing biocapacity per capita each year simply because our population is growing. So as the population grows, the land doesn't grow. And so we have to come up with a different way that you're going to increase enough food production for everybody, because if your land is growing in many parts of the world where your agricultural land is growing, that's usually a bad thing, not a good thing. Usually that means you're tearing down tropical forests and all the rest of that scenario, how much carbon you're releasing. That's the biggest part of when they look at agriculture and land use change. It's the land use portion, which is so detrimental.
Is that a concern, Ted? Is that where, when we're talking about sustainability and we're talking about how we're going to, feed the world for the next generation, the next 100 years, what is that the biggest concern, do you think? Our soil, doing?
It's one of the two. For sure, our ability to support ourselves from a food point of view depends on healthy soils. There's no other ifs, ands, or buts. Canadian Agri-Food Policy Institute is actually supporting 4 doctoral students in Canada who are all looking at this problem. and we're very interested in what they're trying to and what they're trying to come up with. But essentially, it is the foundation of food security is having healthy soils. We lose about 75 billion tons of soil, according to the FAO, each year, just because of erosion, either wind erosion or water erosion, or essentially pollution of those soils. So that's a trend that is going the wrong way. When you add to the fact that we have about 80 million people, you know, additional people per year, then, you know, your biocapacity gets divided by 80 million more people every year. Mm-hmm. And we're essentially saying you can't use more land. So you're beginning to, you begin to narrow down to saying, how do I develop a sustainability out of being able to produce more? The Canadian Agri-Food Policy Institute likes to use a little phrase that kind of sums it up, I think, pretty well. It's the question is, how do we produce more and better with less? Mm. Because so we're talking about what we would term as sustainable intensity. And but the roots of that are soil, and the other one is water. Mm-hmm. Which is, again, something that we're very fortunate to have a fair bit of in Canada. And most of our agriculture is rain-fed. And, you know, that may sound kind of simplistic, but that isn't the case with a good portion of the world, particularly with many of these countries that are in food deficit.
You can even look at California, right, with the droughts, and you don't have to look too far to see that rain isn't always the answer. And I guess that when we're looking at climate change, and I mean it's all connected, mm-hmm. and it all comes back to what we eat, what is on our table every single day, thinking about where that food is coming from. Do you tell people? I want to get into the, how we're using digital, like how we're now, working in a digital way with agriculture. But before I do that, I have so much to ask you, and we're running out of time, but so much to ask you. I do want to say that one of the things that we're trying to do here at the TELUS Talks podcast is we want to give back to our guests something that means, that's important to our guests, and it's a way for TELUS to give back. So we will be giving $500 to the Nature Conservancy of Canada. That's something that you chose. And what do they do at the Nature Conservancy of Canada?
Essentially, they acquire lands and link those lands up to preserve all forms of biodiversity. So you go into their website, you'll see what they're doing in preserving wildlands in Canada, and there's massive amounts that they've done. The link between that and what we're trying to do at CAPI, which, by the way, if for any of those that would wish, they can also, CAPI has a Canadian Agricultural Fund now that it's also a charity. If they're interested in study of an understanding greater about food security globally, and our policies in Canada, how we guide that, CAPI would be happy to take their money too. the key thing I think why those two mesh well is we cannot have a sustainable world if we don't preserve a lot of the wild lands. That's where essentially all the biodiversity exists. And those lands act as carbon sinks. And even if they're in good shape, the most endangered land in Canada is our natural grasslands. And those are huge carbon sinks that have been put there laid down by the animals that were on that land, for millennia. So that plays into agriculture today. One of my biggest worries is that we tend to lose grassland to cropland, and some of that grassland is once you put it into crops, you're dealing with essentially marginal lands in terms of agriculture. So you're going to have very high inputs to keep those marginal lands in good shape. So we do want to, we want to intensify what we do produce in a highly sustainable way for our own use and for the globe. But we also want to preserve the wild lands. And the most important one in Canada to preserve is grassland. And we've lost so much of it already.
You know, Ted, I think I'm like the average person. I go to the grocery store, I buy my food, I plan my meals for my family. I come home, we make them, we eat them. And I don't really think about much else other than what we're going to have for dinner the next night. But it's really important for us, for our agriculture in Canada to be connected. Why is that?
We need to understand better what to produce and how to produce it at the right things at the right time exactly, and so much of this is about data and trying to make data simplistic. So we're getting into a world where we have powerful technologies coming on every front. The idea of remote sensing, so we can see in a big picture for both Canada and the world. But remote sensing takes tremendous amounts of data to move. And we can take that's at the one extreme. At the other extreme, we're beginning to understand deeper, as I said to you, what's in the soil, you know, and how our early warning systems of when our crops are having problems, either with some form of disease or pests. And again, you need early warning systems and data that connects very quickly. Understanding where you've got sudden problems with weather or climate, then you want to be able to think ahead and say, okay, I'm going to lose a certain amount of crop in this area. I need to be purchasing more. Maybe I'm loading up my inventories right now. So it's an end-to-end system, really. You have to know what's going on in the micro sense at the farm. And we've got to be able to, connect that with the distribution system and with the other end with the shopper at the store. Even detecting consumer changes is very important. Going through COVID, everybody began to realize it wasn't that we stopped producing things, which most people thought that was the main problem. For a couple of weeks, we did have problems in some plants in Canada. But the real problem was that, we didn't see until it essentially happened that consumers were nervous. And so they went out and started buying and, stocking up. I don't like the word hoarding because they were doing, in their mind, they were just stocking up and it made good sense. But my God, it changed the dynamics of the system unbelievably. And the second, understanding where everything was at any given time became hugely important when the food service industry, when restaurants essentially shut down, and all that material was packed in packaging that is totally unsuitable for retail use. I mean, people, you're not going to go in and buy 25 kilos of butter. It's a very different game, and it took a while to unscramble that. So you can imagine people trying to figure out where everything was, and what could be moved where to make room for more retail. It was a huge problem. I think one of the interesting things about TELUS Ag that has interested me is, in a strategic sense, they've got that idea. They've got the idea that, we need to be able to look at this thing from end to end to be able to make rational decisions along the way. Farmers need to understand every fall what they're going to plant next spring to be able to buy seed. They need to think ahead on their rotations in their crops. They have to think ahead sometimes up to 4 years, in a sense, because if you suddenly go, I'm just going to, run back-to-back corn, well, you're essentially inviting a problem the next year, or back-to-back canola, then what are you going to do? Because it is, as we said, soil is like a bank account. If you take, and canola takes a fair bit out of the bank. So if you're going to take that out of the bank, what are you going to put back in the bank so you don't have a deficit in the next year? That's what crop rotations do. When you put a crop in place that's going to actually put something back in. Well, TELUS offers the ability to store all that data. And, you know, and I think someday when we develop a little more AI, artificial intelligence use, we can go in and make very, very good decisions based on the data that's there. Mining that data would be phenomenal.
How does that help me as a consumer at home? Like, what is that? What does this mean to me now, this new venture?
It will eventually mean to you a little bit the same, I think, as, well, two things. One, first off, it's going to help keep your food costs the lowest in the world. So people always forget that in North America, when they complain about the cost of food, that U.S. and Canada, without a doubt, have some of the lowest cost foods anywhere in the world, sometimes by a healthy margin. And it's low cost, but also healthy food. So you can eat, food produced in, I won't name a country, but in a food deficit country that has poor soils, and it's going to cost you more. But worse, you're going to not get the nutrition out of it that you require, because the soils don't have the nutrition to give the plants. In Canada, you know, despite the fact that people complain about the cost of food, it is some of the cheapest in the world. But more importantly, it's nutritious. It actually has, you know, it actually has nutrient value. That's a big, big worry in much of the world. And you don't have to worry so much in Canada about, you know, what that food contains. And TELUS would be part of the system to show you that in the thing. For example, because we have Mother Nature as pesticide in Canada. I'm sitting in Toronto today looking outside. We had our first snowfall last night. Well, guess what? That's the best pesticide in the world. And so we have low residue food. People, and you're paying nothing for that privilege of having low residue. Our use, for example, of various forms of ways to kill pests are far lower in Canada than they are in Europe, let alone in most of Asia and Europe. Asia.
I never thought of snow as a pesticide, Ted. That never crossed my mind.
Mother Nature. She's very, very generous. In fact, many parts of the country pray for at least a few cold, really cold days, because once you get down, you know, below zero for a good period of time, it really does do wonders for killing things. And then you have much healthier food.
Go ahead.
I think TELUS is going to help on all that, because a lot of times, part of our problem is we aren't able to see end to end what we have. And I think as consumers get used to being able to, you know, go to a source, or farmers go to a source, everybody going to the same source for the same data, we'll begin to see, you know, what a privilege it is to be here in Canada in this business. Mm.
What's your advice to people when we're shopping for food? Do you have any advice? Like, what are you like when you go to the grocery store? Do you look for where it was grown? Do you look for where it was, like, what are you looking for? What's your advice to us as consumers?
I have always, maybe it's because I know too much about this business, having the scars on my back for years, but where I can, I buy Canadian, and I seriously do. And my only concern is it's getting harder to necessarily know whether it is Canadian. Well-intended people tried to change the labeling, did change the labeling laws some time ago. And the day that it changed, the day after that, we lost a lot of Canadian product. Because, you know, because essentially if you reach a certain point and say, well, less than X percentage, it can't be Canadian. So that meant if you added anything to your food that we didn't grow here, like sugar, for example, or something like that, then you lowered the percentage and you couldn't call the main ingredient Canadian. So I have more difficulty than I used to trying to find it, but I've learned that if it doesn't say product of Canada on the label, it probably isn't. You know, that's true. Or at least the main ingredient isn't. So that's one rule of way of doing it. But so I do tend to do that, to look for that, because I know our standards are extremely high here. There's no standards in the world that are any higher than what we have. So yeah, I would recommend that. And the second thing is, you know, eat a varied diet. You need all the different things from that you can get your hands on. So, you know, tend to spread your diet out as wide as your gut will allow, and give it a chance, and try to also consume things that are going to give your gut some natural bacteria if you can. The gut bacteria is the same as the bacteria in the soil. It's what makes you tick. Most of your immune system is in your gut. So if you want to be healthy, just like healthy plants, you've got to have a healthy gut or healthy soils.
I love it, Ted. I love it. I'm definitely going to have you back, because I know that it's, you know, polarizing to talk about animal agriculture, but that's something that I really love talking about, and I'm mm-hmm. curious about. You are a wealth of information. I could talk about food and how we grow it and how we eat it and how we buy it, all of it. Forever. I could definitely talk to you forever, but I really appreciate you giving us a glimpse. I feel like we just got a little bit of a glimpse at agriculture in Canada, and I'm looking forward to seeing what TELUS Agriculture gets up to, and how it's a game changer for our industry. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. It was wonderful talking with you.
Lovely talking to you too. Thanks, Ted.
Right. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.